coming. Excited to get to talk to you. I get to speak to a lot of different groups, mostly paramedics and EMTs, police officers, physicians. I've been invited to give talks for AIG to insurance executives. So it's a variety of different things. Military, I've been doing some military training over the past 2 years. So the talks sort of vary a little bit depending on who I'm talking with, but I appreciate the opportunity to come talk to you a little bit about EMS medicine, which is probably the newest specialty within medicine overall. And I wasn't really joking, but by the time this hour is over, you'll know more about EMS medicine than my partners in the ER do. It's so new, they don't even understand what I do. So I should probably get to talk to them, actually, but that would be helpful. So thanks for the introduction. I'm going to give you a little bit of background, sort of about where I come from and some of the projects that I'm working on here at Concord Hospital in the Capital Area, some things that we've been doing over the past few years, and hopefully some projects that will extend into the future. So we'll get started. So what is EMS? So what's your idea of EMS? This is going to be group interactive because I hate just flipping through PowerPoints and talking to people, and I know that I have to stay within a 5 foot radius of the middle for the camera, so which is hard for me to sit still. So what is EMS? Can you tell me your thoughts about it? I have some clues on the board, but
911, what's your emergency?
Exactly. So yeah, we've all seen the TV shows with Rescue 911, Johnny and Roy. All different kinds of shows like that. So traditional EMS, emergency medical services, is exactly that. That's what most people think of first. Sometimes that's all they realize that EMS is. It's a lot more, which I'll tell you about. But yeah, 911, I'm having an emergency, I'm going to send you an ambulance. So we call that just traditional ground EMS. So just basic, I'm going to send you an ambulance, they're going to come to your house, take care of you, and take you to the hospital. And it is most of what we do. That's probably the most important part of what we do. But the specialty of EMS has really grown up over the past several years and it's developed into multiple different facets. So I'm going to talk to you a little bit about that aspect and then some of the other areas that I work in. So some of the pictures up here, so aeromedevac, flight medicine is one of them. I used to work in Pittsburgh as a flight physician, which was a really interesting job. Anybody know what this is? That's the track, New Hampshire Motor Speedway. I took it myself from my phone from the end of the track. But so we do, it's called mass gathering medicine or event medicine, whether they be planned events or unplanned mass casualty incidents. So that's within the scope of EMS. Law enforcement support. So that's a newer aspect that has just developed and is continuing to develop over the past 5 years or so, where keeping our police officers safe, giving them training to be able to take care of themselves or their partners in case they're injured. And then integrating that with our traditional paramedics and EMTs to work together to help take care of patients in different sort of scenarios that unfortunately have developed over the past few years, with world events. And this one is, you could think different things of this. This is what I'm going to finish up with at the end, which is called mobile integrated healthcare or community paramedicine. Has anybody ever heard of that? So that's, we'll talk more about it at the end, but that's sort of something using EMS to plug gaps in the healthcare system and integrate different aspects of the healthcare system, which we all know needs better integration and coordination. Okay, so what is EMS medicine? So I'd like to give a corollary to surgery because most people understand that a little bit better. It's a more established, older specialty. Emergency medicine as a specialty is relatively new. It only started in the 80s. So as a specialty of emergency medicine, that's relatively new. Surgery and medicine have been around for hundreds of years, but this has become its own specialty, emergency medicine. So I still get, somebody mentioned, the doctors are getting younger and younger. So the two main comments I get on day-to-day at the ER are you old enough to be a doctor? Yeah. Which seems to be becoming less frequent as the days go on. I don't know, like I'm working too hard. And then what kind of doctor are you going to be when you're done your training? Because traditionally, historically, emergency medicine or the ER was a place that physicians would moonlight while they're in their residency training for other real specialties. And there wasn't actually a specialty of emergency medicine until 20 or 30 years ago. So that's become its own specialty. We train specifically for taking care of emergency patients in the ER. We're not trying to grow up and be surgeons. We do sort of the emergency diagnosis and stabilization of all specialties and then move them either home to back to their primary care doctor or into the hospital for other specialty care. So that's what emergency medicine is. EMS is a subspecialty within emergency medicine. So if you think of surgery, you have general surgeons, That's what you get after your residency. You can go on to fellowship and become a vascular surgeon, a colorectal surgeon, a breast surgeon, all different subspecialties. So EMS medicine is a subspecialty of emergency medicine where we focus on the pre-hospital care of patients and then integration of those patients into the hospital and transition into the ER. And that specialty only developed about 3 or 4 years ago, so that's a brand new specialty. And that was one of the first group of physicians to be able to take that specialty examination and become board certified in EMS, which is pretty exciting. There were two of us in New Hampshire, now there are four. I think there's about 200 nationally, so it's a pretty small new specialty. So what is EMS medicine? It's clinical care of patients in the field. So traditional EMS medicine, before called EMS medical direction, was usually an ER physician that was assigned to oversee the paramedics. And I got this when I started here 6 years ago. A lot of the paramedics would ask me, are you the EMS director because you're the new guy and they made you? I said, no, I actually came here for that. This is my specialty. This is what I love the most. I'll tell my partners I don't love the ER as much. That's great too, but this is what really excites me. So that's why I came to this position. I was able to take this program and move it forward. So we're actually working on clinical care in the field, and that's not just supervising paramedics, but that's actually myself going out in the field and working with them, teaching them, and interacting with them in the field, in the ambulance, in people's homes. And so it's very different. I've never heard that before.
How do you do that? In other words, when a call goes out, you call the ambulance goes out of it. What a hospital.
Right.
So you're at the hospital, correct?
I'm everywhere. Exactly, right. So I can never leave the ER if I'm on duty in the ER. So I have specific days where I'm working out in the field. So I have a car that I'll take out and meet up with the paramedics and EMTs in the field and meet them at calls. Right. Or if it's something major, I may actually go from home. So I get a page when there's a major incident, and I might go straight from home to meet them there.
To the accident scene.
My wife thought that I would outgrow my EMT and firefighter days where I'd be running out at 3 in the morning as a volunteer fireman, but I haven't. She's still waiting for that to happen, but I don't think it's ever going to. So some of the things we do using taking the medicine and the devices and the procedures and evidence from the hospital and moving that out into the field. So the old days of the Hirsch ambulance, you throw the patient in the back and drive to the ER, and if they expire before you get to the ER, it's a Hirsch and you just go to the funeral home. Those days are long gone, so we're bringing a lot of the technology and evidence-based medicine that we do in the hospital out into the field and teaching the EMTs and paramedics to do that. And the scope of the EMTs and paramedics has drastically increased. They can do almost all the things we can do in the ER for any of the conditions that we see, whether it be cardiac arrest, trauma patients. They can do a lot of advanced procedures and technologies, medications, devices, ultrasound, CPAP, all kinds of different things that traditionally have been in-hospital things. We're teaching them to bring that out into the field so that we can deliver that to the patients right in their home, right in their car at the accident scene, and extend the walls of the hospital outside. So it's pretty exciting. Okay, so the program that I'm most proud about, and you'll be able to tell us by the way I talk about it, is what's called operational medical direction. And that's exactly what I sort of was leading into. So that's having the EMS medical director, physician, out in the field, working with the paramedics, EMTs, police officers, firefighters, out in the field, going to calls. So that's new to New Hampshire, which has made it challenging, but we're sort of slowly breaking the physician barrier and getting us out of the hospital. In other places in the country, that's been programs that have been present for 30 plus years. So where I trained in Pittsburgh, that was a program where the residents would actually go out with the paramedics and EMTs and work in the field. And that was, 30 years in making and widely accepted. That was new here. So 2 years ago, we started that program. It was a really nice public-private partnership. We had a car donated by Sheriff Scott Hilliard from Merrimack County Sheriff's Office, one of their old police cruisers. Equipment donated by many of the local fire departments. The trust donated an AED for the vehicle so that we're able to provide emergency defibrillation in the field. And then I had a lot of things that I sort of accumulated along my pathway that we put together and deployed this car, so, which I'm very proud of. So we're actually licensed as an EMS agency. So Concord Hospital EMS is licensed as an EMS agency, just like Concord Fire Department with the state. And we have that vehicle out in the field. So there's my baby. It's, people may find it a little bit, it's a little old. It's a Crown Victoria 2008 with maybe 250,000 miles on it, but the odometer's broken, so we don't really know. It's a workhorse, and it's been great. And it has a very large trunk, so I have everything I need to be able to take care of people in the field. So, going back to your question, so basically I'll take certain days of the week where I'll go out in the field and spend the day out, and I'll go out and visit the fire stations, talk with the EMTs and paramedics, and find out what issues they're dealing with, and then respond to calls in the field with them to help support them. And really, you know, there's different ways to do that. The way I look at it is I'm a resource. This is their patient. I'm there to support them. So I'm not somebody who's going to go in and take over the call from them. I want them to be able to manage the patient because I'm not always going to be there. So I want to be a support system for them, let them run the call. If they have questions or concerns, they can come to me and ask me questions. But otherwise, I'm just a resource. I carry bags for them. I load the stretcher, which always, you know, blows their mind that a doctor knows how to load a stretcher into an ambulance. And if they need medical control, which would be historically, the paramedic would call on the radio, talk to the ER physician for specific orders for medications. They can just turn to me and say, "Hey, doc, can I give this medication?" I say, "Yes." And it cuts down on some of the back and forth. So it's really nice. So some of the benefits of this program, medical care. So this isn't the number one thing that I do as far as frequency, but providing medical care to the patients. The paramedics and EMTs have a lot of skills and equipment. There are certain things that I can do as a physician that they can't do as an EMT, obviously. And so I can provide that higher level of care if needed. I was talking to a group last night, and you know, they were asking sort of about this and what I do, and I told them, at worst case, I'm an initial paramedic. So certain calls where somebody's very severely injured or ill, it's good to have two sets of hands to be able to do advanced procedures. So whether it's putting in IVs, putting in endotracheal tubes to put people on a breathing tube, different things that paramedics can do. There's not enough paramedics around, so I can be that additional set of hands to do that, plus additional skills that they don't have in their scope of practice. Medical decision making, so I've had the opportunity to work in a lot of different, very busy trauma centers, and so the number of patients I see in a day, I've been able to accumulate a lot of experience taking care of patients, and so doing that, it's not as much as the procedures, but just the decision making to say, you know, why do you think this patient is short of breath? Did we think about pneumonia, CHF, pulmonary emboli, different kind of things that can cause it, and talking through the differential diagnosis and learning as we go. So it's the best teaching and learning environment imaginable. Think about the way residents learn in the hospital, taking care of patients with a supervising attending physician above them. Working that interaction is very similar. So we can take care of patients together and we'll learn about the patients directly. And actually the patients love it. You'd think they might mind being, you know, talked over and, you know, talking about their illness. They love it. They love being the center of attention mostly and hearing about what, you know, we're actually thinking about what's wrong with them and, you know, discussing the best ways to treat them. So that's really nice. Mass casualty incidents, I'll talk to you a little bit about some of the incidents that I've had the, let's say, opportunity, I guess, or the fortune to be involved in, and being able to bring that experience to the capital area to help us do the planning and preparation for incidents in this area if they were to happen. Talk about the teaching environment, and then the community integration is huge. So just being out in the field outside of the hospital, I've had people stop me, you know, saying, had a nurse practitioner who's been a primary care nurse practitioner for 20 years in the community. She saw me in an accident scene and she said, "I've never seen anybody from outside of the hospital. It's so great to see you out here." So that's a really nice interaction, both for the paramedics and EMTs. The first year I started it, one of the EMTs told me, "I've never had a doctor at my fire station before." It's great to be able to have that relationship, that interaction. I'll have some of my paramedics will text me, you know, EKGs or, you know, call me and say, "Hey, I have this really interesting case. Can you, you know, find follow-up for me and tell me what happened?" It's been a really good integration and relationship building.
Well, you're probably going to talk about it here.
Yes.
But one of the things that might be a good foundation for the people here is for them to understand what Concord Hospital's responsibility is actually to the EMT paramedic community.
Right.
And what that looks like in terms of scope, and then how you've taken this to a whole different level.
Right, great, thanks. So traditionally, I kind of mentioned about how EMS medical direction was done in the past. It was an ER physician that was usually designated to be in the hospital. And EMS services in New Hampshire are required to have what's called a medical resource hospital, or MRH, which is a hospital that they sign a contract with to provide medical direction and oversight. So we've had that. We have that with 27 agencies that surround the Capitol area. And so that's their medical direction agreement with us. So in that agreement, they agree to, you know, take care of patients appropriately, provide appropriate documentation. We agree to provide medical direction, support, training. We provide them with medications, actually free of charge from the pharmacy here, which is a great benefit to them, and equipment. So we provide them with almost all of their equipment that they use on patients and medications. So it's a really nice relationship that benefits both sides. And then this medical direction program, the operational program, has sort of taken that to the next level where we're out there actually interacting face-to-face with them. So it's been really interesting. So I wanted to sort of break it down into some of the sub-segments and talk to you a little bit about these different areas. So going back to traditional ground EMS, this is, you know, fire trucks and ambulances going to car accidents and going to patients' homes and taking care of them in the field. Again, a resource for them. I have to have the appropriate equipment, personal protective equipment, and gear and training to be able to interact with them in that environment. There's still sort of a feeling that, you know, how could a physician actually work outside of the hospital and work in the field? Are they going to be a liability to us? You know, and that's true in, you know, some respects. You have to have the appropriate training, the situational awareness to be able to function in those environments. It's a different environment, obviously, than working inside the, you know, climate-controlled, well-lit hospital. So that poses different challenges, and that's part of the specific training that I had, both working as a firefighter and EMT in my past, but also the EMS fellowship that I did to become board certified in EMS medicine provides you with that additional training about how to drive an emergency vehicle safely to emergency scenes, how to, you know, not get yourself hurt when you're in this environment helping pull a patient out of a car. So that's some of the work that we do. And again, worst case scenario, I am an additional paramedic. So we had a call in Loudoun a couple weeks ago. They didn't have a paramedic available for a patient who was injured in a motor vehicle accident. All I did was assist the EMTs. I put an IV in, I gave some pain medicine, and then alerted the hospital, alerted the trauma team, got them activated as we brought the patient in. So it was nothing really physician level on those type of incidents, but providing an augmentation to their system that they didn't have available. Other cases, we've done advanced procedures that they're not capable of doing. So tactical EMS, so that's sort of the newer aspect, and that's the law enforcement medical support that I talked about briefly at the beginning. You know, the world is changing. We're seeing active shooter incidents and things that sort of have changed the way we look at mass casualty incidents and things that we have to be prepared for. The hospital's been very proactive on this. We've run two what we call code silver drills where we have plans and a response protocol for dealing with somebody who were to enter the hospital with a gun and start shooting people. It's a terrible thing to have to think about, but you know, the way I look at it, I think you have to prepare for the worst and hope for the best. And sort of the days of thinking something like that can't happen here or just pass, it's not something that you can rely on anymore. So we've been in this area very proactive about doing those protocols, integrating the police departments, the fire departments, EMS agencies, the hospital, the helicopter systems, and getting everything as prepared as we can be for an incident like that if it were to happen. There's a regional SWAT team in the area that, separate from those incidents, would go to sort of high-risk law enforcement incidents. And I help provide some medical direction and training and support for those agencies. So I'm able to help train the police officers about things such as tourniquets and how to take care of themselves or their buddies if they were to be injured and not have access to EMS right near them. And then there are specialized paramedics that work in that environment that we help train to sort of take some of the military training and lessons that have been learned on the battlefield and take that to the civilian aspect and help teach them some of the things that they can do to help protect themselves. So this is the Bearcat that the team has. It's kind of an armored vehicle that they use to go into high-risk areas. And you know, there were some sort of like political differences and disagreements when this was happening, when this was coming to Concord. And, you know, I ask people to sort of look at it in a different way and frame it as it's actually a rescue tool. So think of a citizen who's severely injured or a police officer who's severely injured and being able to get rescue people to that person to be able to provide medical support and evacuate them from that type of scene. So I think that's an important way to look at it. It's not, you know, we're not bringing tanks to Concord and things like that. It's really a rescue tool to help be able to take care of people who are injured to get them out of harm's way. this team, we've developed an ambulance that's specifically designed for these incidents where we do both rehab and then also medical support and for the team members. So if they're on prolonged missions, they get dehydrated, they get cold, they get hot, they get exposed to, you know, they get things in their eyes and twist their ankles and all those kind of things, and we'll take them so that they're not functional, so we can provide medical support. So mass casualty support, I talked a little bit about, that sort of goes the whole spectrum from planned large events to unplanned small events and unplanned large events and sort of everything in between. So taking planning and resources and getting that ready for incidents like this. The biggest planned event that we have around here is NASCAR at the New Hampshire Motor Speedway. So they say that for 2 weekends of the year, Loudoun is the biggest city in New Hampshire, right? So it's at least the numbers are a little down lately, but I think the numbers were 100,000 people or more would come to that race in a weekend. So there's a lot of potential for things to go wrong there. And a lot of it is sort of run-of-the-mill things, dehydration, heat exhaustion. You know, the July race is pretty unbearable to sit on metal benches directly in the sun for 8 hours. So we provide medical support for that, both with nurses, physicians, paramedics, and EMTs. So we, Concord Hospital, for the past several years, have run the first aid services. So there's a sort of small building on the outfield that we provide sort of first aid services for the grandstand area, where we have patients come in and provide all different levels of care to them, from, you know, first aid, the Band-Aid or Tylenol to physician level care, and then transport them out if they need to. One of the goals is to keep people at the event. People don't want to leave. They're excited for this event. They don't want to, you know, they have a small injury. They don't have to go to the hospital. So being able to get them back up and functional so that they can get back to the race safely so they don't have to leave. It's a really nice thing for the patients that really like that. Other small planned events that we do, the rocket race, we provide medical support for that. So we have a tent that we've set up every year now, and have staff from the ER in conjunction with some of the local EMS services where we provide medical standby coverage for that event. We also do that, we did it a few weeks ago for the New England Half Marathon, which is new over the past couple years, runs from the Speedway to the Capitol. They had about 1,000 runners for that doing a half marathon. And then one of the newer sort of programs that we're looking at is bike EMS. So you've seen bike cops, right? Concord has those driving around, and where I did my training in Boston, they had bike EMS. So specifically for the Boston Marathon, there are places where you can't get an ambulance quickly with road closures, crowds. So they had great success with bike EMS. So a paramedic or EMT on a bike with a backpack that has an AED and a first aid kit, being able to get places where ambulance can't, to get the patients very quickly. They've had great success with that. Cardiac arrest patients have, you know, they've gotten to them within 2 minutes, provided defibrillation, and the patient's awake and talking to them, asking what happened on the way to the hospital. So it's really incredible. So this last race, I tried this program. So this is my own mountain bike, and got it sort of fitted for this function. Provided a backpack, my AED from the trust in my backpack, and rode around the New Hampshire Motor Speedway stands and provided support for the paramedics and EMTs. So it was a new, different thing, but we're looking at trying to bring it to the fire departments and EMS agencies for things like market days and some of these, you know, mass gathering events. So those are the planned events. There are unplanned events, obviously, that happen too. So mass casualty incidents or sort of non-traditional EMS calls. So this was actually the plane crash in Warner from a few months ago that you heard about. Small plane, 2 patients, but a difficult challenge for traditional EMS services. So this was out in the middle of the woods at, you know, 1 a.m, and how do you access those patients, bring them medical care that's appropriate to stabilize them, and then evacuate them out of the woods to get them to the hospital, the challenge. So I was able to respond to that scene from home in my car, and I hiked out into the woods with the paramedics and EMTs, got to the crash site, helped stabilize and package the patients, provided pain medication. They had orthopedic injuries, I was able to provide pain medication for them and stabilization, do an advanced trauma assessment, and then package them and help carry them out of the woods. So it took probably 3 hours from beginning to end, and they did fine and got them out and to the hospital eventually. But it was a different sort of challenging role that was nice to be able to provide that level of care and support right to the scene. So it was a really rewarding experience getting to work with these guys for that. So bigger events, so bigger unplanned events and bigger planned events. So a little bit outside of the role I do here, I work for the federal government as an intermittent employee as a reserve federal medical officer. So I provide support for larger planned events. So this is the Capitol, so we provide support for events. I might be going to the inauguration, hopefully, but large scale, what are called national security special events that are felt to be sort of high risk for needing medical support, both sort of just day-to-day things with people that are dehydrated and trip and sprain their ankle to, you know, something more catastrophic that were to happen. Boston Marathon bombing. So that was a couple years after I finished my training in Boston, but every year I continued to go down and work at the marathon tent. So I had the opportunity to be at the finish line medical tent for the Boston Marathon bombing and was able to respond within minutes to right to the bombing scene and provide triage and stabilization and transport of the patients out of that area. So, you know, that was obviously a really powerful experience. I could talk to you about that for 2 hours alone. But that, you know, taking some lessons out of that and bringing those lessons back to New Hampshire and the Capital area has been really powerful to help us design our mass casualty plans and response protocols for this area. So it's been it was a terrible experience in a way, but a really powerful, great experience that I've been able to pull a lot of lessons out to apply to our local area. This is this is Haiti in 2010. As part of the federal team, I went to Haiti after the earthquake in 2010. And we set up a tent hospital for two weeks where we took care of patients doing surgeries and stabilization and then evacuation of patients from their hospital if they couldn't handle the patients to our tent, which seems like you're going downhill, but it was actually uphill care, and then evacuating them out to the Navy ship Comfort that was in the harbor. So that was another sort of unique experience getting to provide first world medical care in a third world country in a major disaster area. All these things have been sort of lessons that I've been able to take out and apply to a local area. So mobile simulation, that's not a real patient, sorry. It's a little bit graphic anyway, but it's a simulator. So we partner with the simulation lab here with my partner that runs out, Dr. Four, and we go out to local fire departments and EMS agencies to provide medical training for them. So last night we were in Barnstead. We've done, I think, 6 sessions over the past year and a half, going to various towns. We were in Laconia last month, and our sort of area has expanded outside of the catchment area in the immediate capital area to some of the other areas that we were mentioning before the lecture that we've been starting to provide more service to. So because of the specialty line development that has been happening here with trauma and cardiac care specifically, we've seen patients coming from farther away than just our immediate capital area over the past few years. So that's been a really exciting experience to help take care of those patients with specialty care that isn't available at their local hospital. And so in return, we go out and provide training for those local EMTs and paramedics to help them, you know, sort of identify those really, you know, high-risk diagnoses and provide them the training to provide medical support and transport for those patients. So that's been a really rewarding experience. So this is the ambulance that I got to drive last night. It's an old Concord Fire Department ambulance that they donated to us, I think, back in 2009. And then the trust helped support the sort of, you know, paint job. It used to look like this, red and white, and now it's our Concord Hospital colors. But
it was one of the hardest contributions to get was the paint job.
Really?
Yeah, you'd be surprised the hard contributions to get, but getting that painted was one of the most difficult.
Well, it looked beautiful. it's a tank, believe me. It runs parallel to a big diesel, and you have to warm it up, and it won't go over 60 with the pedal to the floor. But it's great. So there aren't many mobile simulation labs around, even nationally, so this is one of the few, actually. I was talking to the simulation staff last night, and they go to a national conference every year to talk about simulation, and most of the programs are at large academic hospitals and medical schools and things, and there are very, very few that are based in community hospitals like Concord Hospital, and there's even fewer still that have a mobile component like this. So we have these simulators that you can do. I mean, you can just kind of get the picture from how graphic that is, but you can do almost any kind of procedure that we might need to do in a trauma patient or a medical patient to these simulators. And this one's actually wireless, so they did some training for the National Guard a few years ago, they're able to take that, put it in a Black Hawk helicopter, and it flies away, and they do all the procedures and treatments to that simulator, and then fly it to the hospital and unload it, and it will record vital signs, it blinks, we had a pediatric mannequin we were using last night that the lips get blue and to simulate cyanosis or low oxygen levels, and they're really, really amazing, but they're actually a little bit scary, actually, because they look like they're almost real. The training that we had last night in Barnstead, one of the firefighters brought his four-year-old son, and the simulator, the pediatric simulator we have, is about the size of a six-year-old, so he was just totally fascinated with the simulator that was about his size, and I think he was a little freaked out about it, but he was very interested in looking at this simulator. So.
Do they have the ability to vocalize pain?
They can, yeah. So they come with a laptop or tablet that's connected to them by Bluetooth, and one of the staff members will run that while we're doing the scenario. So they can plug in whatever vital signs they want it to have, and you can actually check vital signs with a blood pressure cuff on these simulators. You can attach EKG electrodes, and on the tablet you can plug in whatever cardiac rhythm you want it to show. And their real monitor that they use day to day, they can put on the simulator and it'll read whatever rhythm we type into it. You can do this endotracheal tube, you can do airway management with them. Start IVs, you can do needle decompressions where we put a needle in somebody's chest to relieve air pressure buildup if they have a collapsed lung. So, and then they have voice too, so they have programmed phrases they can say, help me, ouch, whatever. But then they also have a voiceover where you can actually talk through a microphone and project your voice through them. So, you should come and see our simulation lab if you haven't sometime downstairs. It's really incredible.
Sounds like an opportunity for What's Up, Doc.
I think so.
And then go through.
Dr. Ford is going to thank me for it's a really amazing program. And so, this aspect of rolling it into what we're doing with EMS education and training has been a really nice thing that we've just developed over the past year to get out and bring that technology outside of the hospital to the EMTs and paramedics who really, really need it. So it's been really rewarding. And back to the comment of we've never seen a doctor in our fire station. Some of these simulators are very, very expensive, and being able to bring that technology out to them where they don't have always the best resources or funding to be able to bring that to them and teach them on this state-of-the-art technology has been really great. And a lot of them have never even seen this level of simulator before. They use the sort of resuscitation A&E, if you've seen those things, this sort of plastic airway head or CPR mannequin, which are great for their purpose, but that's sort of the extent of exposure that a lot of them have had to some of this stuff. So getting out with these really high fidelity simulators and mannequins has been really cool. It's a nice relationship building exercise too, and getting outside of the capital area. This picture is from Laconia from last month, outside of our sort of traditional catchment area. Bringing these services and talking about the things that we can do for patients here at Concord Hospital has been really good. It just comes back to really good patient care, and that's the whole goal of all this is to teach our EMTs and paramedics, police officers, and integrate with the hospital so that we can do take the best care of our patients and get them the right services that they need. I talked a little bit about the active shooter training with the tactical EMS support. Concord is actually the first city in New Hampshire that has a joint protocol between the police department and the fire department. So again, we hope this never happens here, but if it does, we have a pretty robust plan that we spent the past year putting together and training and exercising with the support of Concord Hospital to provide a training venue here for the drill. These are Concord police officers, and these are actually firefighter EMTs. You couldn't tell by the way they're dressed, but the idea is to get to patients who are injured as fast as possible in a safe way so that we can provide advanced medical care to patients even in what's called a warm zone of an active shooter area. So after the suspect has left, we get in there and provide medical care to them immediately so we can try to stabilize the patients and then evacuate them out as fast as possible. So the EMTs will go in with the police officers for security. The police officers set up a perimeter around them so they can do some initial stabilization and triage, and then they'll move as an element out together, extricating the patient out to the waiting ambulances where we can provide them sort of more traditional EMS support and get them to the appropriate resource. So again, it's a little bit sort of frightening to think about having to need this capability, but I feel it feels rewarding to be able to have done this here and say that we're as prepared as we could be for that type of situation. And again, hopefully it never happens. Okay, so mobile integrated healthcare. You know, most people have not heard about this. The older term is community paramedicine. So how many people have been a patient in the healthcare system? All of us, right? How many people have found it difficult to navigate the healthcare system? Yeah, so, you know, I know from my experience, both with family members and myself, being patients at different times, that finding the right access point or a way to navigate the healthcare system is much harder than it should be. And you have all these entities that exist, and we're pretty lucky in this area where we have Concord Hospital Medical Group that's, you know, we're very geographically sort of, let's say isolated, but we're a compact area that the integration is actually pretty good here compared to some other systems that I've worked in. But even given that, there are challenges for patients and they're not really sure how to best access the system a lot of times. If you had a sprained ankle, what's the best thing to do with that? Is it go to the ER? Is it call your primary care doctor? Is it go to an urgent care center? And you know, how do you best access that for both the system and the patient? So one of the ideas is to take some of the existing EMS resources, because they're in every community, mostly fire department based in this area, and use those resources that exist to help plug the gaps in the system and help navigate, help the patients navigate through the system. So we're working on a program here to help use these paramedics to, you know, keeping the patient in the center, help them access whatever resource they might need. So I'll give you a couple of examples. So one would be post-discharge care. So if somebody is admitted to hospital for congestive heart failure, they're discharged home, they are waiting for their primary care visit. One of the ideas is that, and these are pilot programs that are going around the country, we're looking at the best way to structure this here. One of the ideas is to send the local fire department paramedic to the patient's house a couple days post-discharge to do sort of an in-home checkup. So they have advanced training in, you know, vital signs, they can do an EKG, they can check your weight, they can look at your medications, make sure you're taking them correctly, and then coordinate back with the healthcare system. So they can call the primary care doctor and say, okay, Mr. Smith is doing pretty well, he needs a post-discharge visit with you in 2 days. Doing well, the primary care doctor could then say, you know, based on this information you're telling me, I'd like to make this dosage change to his medication. Can you start an IV and give him this dose of this medication? I think he needs that to help him get through to the appointment. Sure. Another option might be, you know, Mr. Smith is not doing so well. He's sort of going downhill since he's been discharged. He actually has to go back to the emergency room to maybe get admitted and get, you know, stabilized and for advanced treatment. So using that paramedic as sort of a bridge or liaison to help the patient guide through the system and help them access the system in the right area.
How's that different with VNA service?
So it augments. It doesn't replace VNA, but it augments that. So some people don't qualify for VNA. Some people refuse VNA for different reasons. And they're also not always available, both for like staffing, hours, manpower, those kind of things. So this is it's a great question. So this is actually to augment but not replace the VNA system. And the VNA has been super supportive of this idea because they realize those limitations of their system. And so just, you know, the way that EMS is so community-based in New Hampshire, usually based out of the fire department, people a lot of times are more likely to accept that resource sometimes. They don't see it as an outside resource coming from, you know, the VNA or the hospital or something. They feel like, oh, all right, Hoppington Fire Department, I know those guys, they're part of my community. They're more willing to accept them into their home and let them access them. So, yeah.
Is there a charge to the patient?
So there's different ways to structure it. So right now, EMS is only reimbursed if they transport a patient to an ER. And that's based on CMS regulations for Medicare and Medicaid. So that's one of the challenges to the system. Some of these pilot programs that have taken off around the country are either grant-based, or sometimes the hospital system will support those systems to say, all right, it costs the system less to be able to take care of a patient either in their home or at the primary care doctor, or to identify that Mr. Smith is going downhill before it's too late and be able to turn him around before he needs an expensive ER, ICU stay, or something like that. So there are different funding models, but that is one of the challenges going forward, that we're looking at legislation change, which would be necessary to change that sort of traditional payment model for EMS, because, you know, historically, it's been 911, what's your emergency? I drive you to the hospital. That's all EMS historically did. And so trying to break that barrier and get outside of that to think in a different way. And so there are a lot of programs like this around the country offering that, but we're looking at different ways that we can do this. So there are many different aspects to this, but one that's actually about to go live is a coordination with Riverbend Emergency Mental Health Services. So within the past year, they started what's called a mobile crisis unit, which are mental health clinicians that actually go out to patients' homes who are having an acute mental health emergency. So whether they're feeling acutely depressed or anxious or suicidal even, the Riverbend Mobile Crisis Unit can actually go to the patient's house and provide an emergency evaluation in their home and get them to the right resource. So again, historically, all those patients would be taken to the ER, where we know that's not the best place for a mental health emergency. And unfortunately, with the state resources the way they are, a lot of times they're stuck in the ER for days sometimes. It's a terrible situation. So looking at this a different way, people have realized that doing that evaluation in the home in that environment, only about 15% of those patients end up needing emergency involuntary admission, say, to New Hampshire Hospital, versus if they're seen in the ER, about 80% of those patients end up being committed to a hospital, and they're the same patients. So it's something about the setting and, the way we sort of interact with patients, both the setting here versus the setting at home. So the mobile crisis unit has been doing this, and we're about to go live with a program with Concord Fire where if somebody calls 911 for an acute mental health emergency, the EMTs and paramedics will go to their house, provide an initial medical screening for them to make sure there's no acute medical issue, and then call the mobile crisis unit, who can then come to the home, and they work together and to get the patient the right resource. So the whole idea of this is to get the right resource to the right patient at the right time. And traditionally, I think medicine has done a poor job of doing that historically. We're trying to sort of fix that. So there's a couple different aspects of this. So the patient might felt to be safe to stay there and then follow up with their clinician the next morning. They might need to go to the emergency department if there's either a medical condition or they're just felt to be not safe otherwise. Or there's actually a protocol where the paramedics will transport the patient in the ambulance to a primary psychiatric facility, not New Hampshire Hospital, but a Riverbend community mental health facility. There's one on Pleasant Street. And so it's basically like apartments where they have 24/7 mental health clinicians to help support that patient. So we're very excited that this is a better way to get patients the care that they need at the right time without having them stuck in the ER. The ER is a good place for anything, but not everything should just go right there. So we're very excited to be able to start that in partnership with Riverbend and Concord Fire Department.
And that's initiated by calling 911, just like a physical emergency.
Right, there's different ways. So again, it's sort of however the patient accesses the system, we'd like to help them navigate to the right resource. So it might be that they call 911 and the fire department EMTs get there, they can access them that way, but then instead of just taking them to the ER, they can redirect them to the appropriate resource. The mobile crisis unit has a specific number that you can call 24/7 and access them directly, and then you can access the system that way, and they may come to your house or initiate the process that way. And so we're trying to expand that. We've had people from the ER who actually called the mobile crisis unit and said, can you do a phone triage with this person? We don't think they're having a severe emergency right now. Can we get them to an outpatient resource? And that's worked also. So, and then giving that number to the primary care offices so that if they access the system in that way, they can get plugged in the right way. And we're looking at expanding this to different other non-mental health medical emergencies. Give you the example of your ankle sprain. So you call 911, you stubbed your toe and sprained your ankle. I know nobody in this room would call 911 for that, but believe it or not, it happens. And will we see you in the ER for that? Happily, of course. But is there a better way for you, the patient, to access that care in a less expensive, totally prompt way? So it might be that you call and we say, all right, we'll send a paramedic out to check you out. Your ankle looks good based on these criteria. We can set you up for an outpatient x-ray in 4 hours at your primary care office. And you would actually get the care faster than having to be stuck in the ER waiting room for 4 hours or something. So we can actually get you to the appropriate resource. Or could we schedule you, an outpatient x-ray or outpatient appointment that you can follow up with in an appropriate time frame? Okay, so Those were a lot of the topics I wanted to cover. I wanted to save a little bit of time for discussion. So these are my kids who love Daddy's police car, they call it. I'm using my hand in the back, but it's my 6-year-old, 4-year-old, and almost 2-year-old. And they love my Daddy's car. I think they're going to be paramedics when they grow up, no matter what I do. It's been a really rewarding, I've been here for 6 years now, I can't believe it, but it's been a really rewarding 6 years. And the transition from how the program was when I picked it up to how it is now has been really rewarding. And, you know, I have to remind myself that too, because the day-to-day sort of grind, you sort of forget, you lose perspective of, you know, where you've come from. And we've made a lot of good progress and relationship building and outreach over the past 6 years has been really rewarding. So I think we're taking better care of our patients than we did 6 years ago and doing better integration within the system, bringing higher level medical resources and devices out to the patients, and doing, and we're now working on sort of follow-up care and integration that we can sort of bring all these resources.